Testing. Hi, my name is Zach Jones. No, don't listen to that.
I just told you.
I saw you.
Testing. Hi, my name is Zach Jones. No, don't listen to that.
I just told you.
I saw you.
Hi, my name is Zach Jones. No.
thank you all for coming on a beautiful Friday in the middle of the summer. Today we're here to celebrate the culmination of Zach's PhD studies at Colorado School of Mines. Zach's been here for 6 or 7 years. And he's published about as many papers in that period of time. He's done a really good job. He's been an exemplary student, a total leader in the lab, a go-to for so many new people who are coming in for what they do. He's played leadership roles and renew it in terms of your vice president of student organizations, student organizations within CSM as well. And has really developed a wonderful network that really is a function of Zach's personality and his excitement about what he's doing. Zach came to us from UC San Diego, a little stint in biotech before that. Interestingly enough, he was also babysat by one of my good friends from graduate school, James. And so originally, when I first got here as a professor, I was looking for students, and James said, I have a student you really need to look at. So James, how do you know this person? Well, I used to babysit for him. It turned out really well despite that. But I guess you get a really good feeling for somebody's personality as a function of that. So Zach's going to talk to you guys about the work that he's been doing on engineered wetlands and a lot of really cool fundamental insights with really interesting and really potentially meaningful applications on this work and sort of folding in this concept of environmental microbiology with environmental engineering to bring further insights into what might otherwise be a black box type system. So without further ado, I'll turn the floor over to Zach.
So, well, thank you for the introduction, Josh, and thank you guys for coming today. I'm really excited to share my dissertation work with you today. It's titled Microbial Ecology and Functional Insights into Containment Bioattenuation Engineered Shallow Open Water Wetlands. Before I start digging into some of this data, I just wanted to thank the Open Water Wetland team in Renew It. It was led by Dr. David Sudlack and supported by Dr. Karen Nelson and, of course, my advisor, Josh. And the main students I collaborated with were at UC Berkeley, Dr. Justin Jasper, Samantha Barron, and Dr. Mi Nguyen. You'll see some of their work throughout this presentation just to give broader context to the work that I did. So a brief overview of what we're going to be talking about today. There will just be some background information on wetlands and trace organic pollution, and we'll get into chapter 2 of my dissertation, which is trace organic degradation. Chapter 3 deals with nitrogen cycling in Animox, and we'll give a little bit of background about nitrogen cycling there. And chapter 4, we'll look at microbial community establishment in this wetlands and comparison of pilot scale and demonstration scale systems. And then we'll talk about some future directions and conclusions. So first off, I wanted to start off by talking about wetlands. What are wetlands? I think everyone kind of has maybe a different idea of what a wetland is, maybe dependent on where you grew up. But there's coastal and freshwater wetlands. Usually there's some vegetation. And their kind of defining characteristics is they're biologically diverse and metabolically very active. So we try, when we make constructed wetlands, so man-made wetlands, we try to mimic natural wetland systems because they are biologically diverse and metabolically active. That gives them a lot of potential to break down a broad suite of pollutants. And in 2000, there was over 600 constructed wetlands in the United States. I imagine that number has grown quite a bit by now. And this image down here, this is just like the typical constructed wetland, surface flow constructed wetland we think of. There's a liner, inlet, outlet. There's some kind of hydraulic residence time, substrate for plants to grow in, like cattails. And so when we make these constructed wetlands, we have some typical design considerations, usually hydrology, sizing, nutrient loading, just determining how big the wetland's going to be, local ecology, so endangered species, plant types, and then you also have to think about vector control, public access and outreach, regulations, And then I added biology on the bottom here. And so that's kind of going to be the theme of this dissertation. My presentation is, can microbiology be utilized in design considerations? Typically, as Josh said, these have been kind of black box systems that haven't been well understood. And I think we have the technology and methods now to start analyzing these systems a little bit better. So I'm going to try and convince you of that today. And so now just getting into some background about trace organic pollutants. This was a study done by the USGS, and they sampled surface and groundwater sources for a variety of trace organic pollutants. And the summary of what they found is they found pretty much a lot of what they looked for almost everywhere, all across the United States, things like steroids, non-prescription drugs, disinfectants, detergents. This is a pretty big problem, and you can see this is kind of a recent revelation in 2002. This was, I think, another USGS study where we have all these trace organic pollutants in our water, right? And so this was a study done on a drinking water treatment plant. And basically, they're going through the different steps of water treatment and looking at the concentrations of different trace organic pollutants here. So basically, the summary of this figure is you'll notice all the shapes which stand for the different steps in the water treatment process are all clustered together. This just means they're not really effectively removing much of these trace organic pollutants, and they're getting piped straight to your tap, essentially. So this brings about the unit process open water cell. This is a picture of what it looks like. This is in Discovery Bay, California, a little bit northeast of Berkeley. The cell was originally designed by David Sedlak's group to treat trace organic contaminants via photolytic degradation. You can see there's no vegetation here, and we have a liner lined with cement or a textile liner on the bottom. And you can see baffling here, just to prevent short circuiting. So it's designed as kind of a plug flow reactor. And some of Justin's early work looked at photolytic degradation in these wetland cells. The idea is you have sunlight and nitrate, you can form singlet hydroxyl radicals, which are pretty aggressive at breaking down a variety of pollutants. But what Justin found was there was actually faster removal rates in the wetland cell than what he was observing in his solar lab simulations. So this is kind of where I got brought into this project. You'll notice you can kind of see this green biomat on the bottom of the wetland cell here. That's going to be the main topic of this presentation. And why I was brought on to this project was to see who's there, kind of what are they doing? Are they helping to break down some of these pollutants? And can we start to look at conditions to improve the trace organic degradation? So those are kind of the goals of my first chapter I'm going to talk about here. So to start off with, who's there? We basically took some of this green biomat and threw it under a microscope. In panel A here, this is a fluorescent image. And you can see the red and green here. The red is the autofluorescence of the chloroplasts and the diatoms, which you can be seen in panel B here via SEM imaging. And then the green is just a general DNA stain, cyber green. So you can kind of see that everything is associated with these diatom flocks. Additionally, we did some 16SR RNA gene sequencing. For now, you can ignore the x-axis. We're going to talk about that later. But the main message I want to convey with this data here is we just had a very diverse community. There's lots of proteobacteria here, pretty much almost all of the different superclasses. And stromatopiles is the big pink bar here. Stromatopiles is another name for diatoms. So they're making up about 30% of the community, but this is a diatom chloroplast, 16S chloroplast sequences, so it can't be really directly compared abundance-wise. And yeah, there's just a ton of stuff in there. I want to talk a little bit more about diatoms because they're such a prominent member of this community. Diatoms have silica cell walls. They're phototrophic, but can also have heterotrophic metabolisms. And they're the main cause of these diurnal fluctuations we're seeing in this system. So in the daytime, when the diatoms are photosynthesizing, producing supersaturated concentrations of oxygen in the water column, up to 20 plus milligrams per liter, and this causes the pH to go up to about 10 as well during the daytime. And at nighttime, the oxygen can drop down to almost anoxic in the water column and a pH of about 7.5 or 8. And diatoms are also known to host symbiotic relationships with bacteria. So our experimental design to see if this biomat was significantly contributing to trace organic degradation, we did a microcosm study. And the goal of this study was to look at biological contribution to trace organic degradation. And we did that by, we also layered on the variable of light and dark conditions for this experiment. And we used a red LED light to prevent photo degradation while still be able to induce photosynthesis in the diatoms, as they have chlorophyll C, which can absorb light at around 640 nanometers. And this light is not powerful enough to degrade the trace organic pollutants. You need a higher energy wavelength. And we also had some white lights for biological control to ensure that the red light didn't have any effects on the community. So this is a kind of a summary of the analytical chemistry portion of this experiment. In red is our controls up top here, and we tested a suite of trace organic pollutants. The top three are different beta blockers. These are thought to be more biologically labile, or more labile in general in the environment. And then on the bottom we have trimethoprim, sulfamethoxazole, and carbamazepine. These are antibiotics and anticonvulsant over here. So if you look at the legend here, we have green and black markers. The filled-in markers are the aqueous concentrations, and the open markers are the sorbed amount of trace organics found in the biomass, so we controlled or accounted for sorption as well. And the black circles are dark conditions, the green circles are light conditions, and basically what you see in the top up here with these beta blockers is that the light conditions generally have faster removal rates for these trace organics. Which is about what we thought would happen. Just, you know, you have more energy entering the system, more metabolic activity happening. And I thought, and the more interesting part of this experiment actually is that with the more recalcitrant trace organics, we're getting faster removal in the absence of light or in the dark conditions. So we wanted to kind of look into why might this be happening. Our first thought was, well, maybe the community is changing over time. You know, 6 days in the dark is a long time. It could be perturbed, you know, from the original starting community. But you can see here, this is where the x-axis comes into play. We have day zero, and then the end of the experiments in the dark and the red. The white lights had the same community as well, so it didn't affect anything. But you can see we have an unchanged community throughout the course of this experiment, both in the light and the dark reactions, which is usually not what we're trying to look for when we use 16S RNA sequencing. We usually try and look for differences, but we can still say something with this. So we know that a shift in the community is not affecting the degradation in the light and dark conditions. So what does this mean? What can be the factors affecting this trace organic degradation? And so the main driver, the main difference in light and dark is the absence of photosynthesis, right? And so photosynthesis produces oxygen. So if you have less oxygen, this can lead to different redox conditions and perhaps activate different metabolisms that are better at breaking down some of these pollutants. Diatoms also produce a lot of carbon when they photosynthesize in the form of extracellular polymeric substances. And we think that if you have less carbon, microorganisms can kind of go into scavenging mode and be willing to utilize some of these compounds a bit more readily. And in addition, I mentioned diatoms can have be photosynthesizing or consuming carbon. So if they're changing metabolisms in the dark, they can be contributing to some of this trace organic degradation as well. And then so to kind of summarize this data, we compared the summer pilot scale wetland removal rates in the dark bars here, and then we matched the laboratory mechanisms up to it to kind of fill in the gaps of Justin's photolytic model. And so Justin's photolysis model is in the hatched bars here. And so you can see things like atenolol and metoprolol, which were poorly removed by photolysis, were better removed by the microorganisms, or these microcosms, which are just the slash bars here. And this this accounted for a lot of the differences in, that we were seeing in the field rates and Justin's solar simulated rates. So in conclusion with this chapter, we're seeing a diverse microbial community with a dominant single species of diatoms. The biology in this system is contributing to trace organic degradation, and those that are poorly removed photolytically are better removed biologically. This might make sense to you if you had the opportunity to take Chris Higgins' organic chemistry class. And I think a lot of this has to do with aromaticity of the compounds. Those that are more aromatic or have more ring structures are more readily broken down photolytically, and they're harder to break down biologically, and vice versa. And we found that more recalcitrant trace organics are better removed in the absence of light for the reasons I previously described. And so this, we're going to switch gears a little bit here and talk about nitrogen cycling really quickly. This is kind of diagram of the nitrogen cycle. You'll notice it's largely driven by, at least in this figure, soil microorganisms or aquatic microorganisms are the main drivers of the cycle. This is a figure from a paper looking at global nitrogen cycling. You can see this is the atmosphere up here, land, ocean, and the orange are the anthropogenic contributions to the nitrogen cycle. And the main point I wanted to get across with this figure is that humans are responsible for over 50% of the nitrogen fixation in the world, which is, that's both taking into account land and ocean nitrogen fixation. So we're essentially doubling the amount of reactive nitrogen in the environment. So of course this is going to have some consequences, right? And so nitrate contamination in the United States is a pretty big problem. This is another USGS study looking at the increasing risk of groundwater contamination. You'll notice it's largely driven in the Midwest by agriculture and, of course, California, Central Valley. Municipal wastewater is also a significant source of nitrogen pollution. This pollution, it gets basically funneled into streams and rivers, which pour out into the ocean. And this is a graphic, I think, put together by NASA. And these red dots are all the studied dead zones throughout the world. There are some kind of gray dots that are hard to see. The magnitude of those dead zones just haven't been explored yet. And I imagine there's even more that haven't been documented. So this is a pretty big problem. These dead zones form because all the nitrogen goes into the ocean, you get algal blooms, the algae dies, all the carbon goes into the water column, and the microorganisms consume the carbon and also utilize oxygen, and basically using all the oxygen in the water, leading to the death of most of the macro life. So this brings us back to the Discovery Bay wetland again. So this chapter is also going to be talking about the same wetland as the previous chapter. There's an influent nitrate concentration into this wetland of about 20 milligrams per liter. That's quite a bit. It's double the MCL for nitrate, the discharge MCL for nitrate. And over this time, while we were studying the trace organic work, we saw a buildup of this biomat. So near the inlet, it was about 15 centimeters in depth, and about, it tapered off about 4 centimeters near the outlet. When we monitored nitrate removal in this wetland, we saw about 90+% removal of the nitrate during the summer months, and this dropped off to about 25% removal in the winter, which is pretty typical of natural treatment systems just because of the decrease in temperature. But this 90% removal, or the overall annual removal rate, is better than about 75% of the reported removal rates for traditional vegetated wetlands. So we were pretty excited about this. This was not really the original design purpose of this wetland, but it ended up doing a really great job at it. So after we kind of found this out, we wanted to explore the nitrate removal mechanisms in the system and understand the pathways responsible for its removal. And so the main way you remove nitrogen is the formation of N2 gas. So you're removing it from the water column, gassing it off into the atmosphere, which is already 90% N2 gas. And so we're starting with nitrate here at the bottom, as we already have fully nitrified wastewater. And denitrification is the typical removal pathway, or you know, the traditionally thought to be responsible for removal of nitrate in wetlands. So nitrate to nitrite to nitric and nitrous oxide, and then to N2 gas. The red kind of letters here, names, are the genes that are responsible or usually queried for each of these steps. And so we're going to be talking especially about Nrf and Nrk a little bit. And so the other way to form N2 gas is through the Anammox pathway, and this uses nitrite, or the intermediate nitric oxide, and ammonium to form its combined form, and N2 gas, and hydrazine is the intermediate here, and this HZSA, or hydrazine synthase gene, is the gene we queried for Anammox. So we have ammonia. How do you get ammonia? And typically ammonia is fixed from the atmosphere from N2 gas, and then it can be nitrified to nitrite and back to nitrate, and that completes the nitrogen cycle. Additionally, you can form ammonia by dissimilatory nitrate reduction to ammonium, or DNRA. So that's pretty much it. We're going to talk about this again, so don't feel bad if you can't memorize all that right now. So this is some quantitative PCR data, preliminary data, and for my committee members who might be following along on my dissertation, this data is included in chapter one, but I give some good background to this chapter. So we looked at NRS and NRK for denitrification. You'll notice there's a pretty large abundance of NRS. This is pretty typical in aquatic systems. These genes have redundant functionality. NRS is found in aquatic environments. NRK tends to be found more in soil environments. So this made a lot of sense. And then we also queried for HZS, which was responsible for Anammox. Interestingly, I wasn't expecting to find Anammox in the system, which we'll talk about in a little bit, but we did get some hits for Anammox, and it appeared to be enriched in the bottom of the wetland. This is top and bottom for each sampling spot here. And so when we found this out, Justin ran some microcosm experiments, and A and B here, we have our spike with ammonium, and when nitrite or nitrate was added to these microcosms, we thought we saw a slight decrease in ammonium here compared to the control C here, and we thought that Anammox could be responsible for 15 to 20% of the nitrogen removal, which is not insignificant. So the experimental goals of this chapter were mainly to understand why we're seeing Anammox in this system. This is a primarily heterotrophic system. Anammox organisms are autotrophic organisms and usually thought to be competed by heterotrophs. And additionally, this is fully nitrified wastewater that this system's receiving. So the precursors for Anammox aren't provided, at least in the inlet waters. We also wanted to look at the spatial microbial community distribution and understand which mechanisms are supporting Anammox. So the experimental design, we did a more in-depth field sampling event where we kind of did a three-dimensional sampling of this biomass. So we sampled along the flow path from inlet to outlet, and at each of those spots we also sampled with depth at top, middle, and bottom. So we had about 36 total samples. And with each of those samples, we also centrifuged out pore water and looked at nutrients in the pore water. And then the DNA we extracted from each of the biomass samples, we did 16S RNA gene sequencing again, and also did more quantitative PCR for some of the functional genes that I previously talked about. And then we also took some of those biomat and put it in microcosms spiked with nitrate and sulfide. So this is kind of a summary of the 16S RNA sequencing data. This is a principal coordinate analysis using weighted unifrac distance matrices. Basically, to understand this graph, you just need to know that the closer the points are in the graph, the more similar they are, and the farther away the points are, the more different the communities are. So we can see some pretty interesting trends in community stratification here. I wanted to start with looking at the colors. You can see we kind of go from red to green and purple over here, so this corresponds to inlet to outlet. So we're seeing this community stratification, which we think is largely driven by nutrient gradient. If you're removing 90% of the nitrogen in the system, you're going to have a pretty significant nitrogen gradient from inlet to outlet, not to mention other nutrients that we need to query for. Additionally, we're seeing this community stratification with depth as well. And if you look at the shapes, so we have the circles here, top, middle, the bottom, so moving from bottom right to top left, we see the stratification with depth, and we think that's largely driven by redox gradients, as we have an oxic community on top and a heavily reducing community on the bottom, which we can see here. And so this is just looking at the top and bottom samples of the inlet. There's a lot going on in this figure, so I'm going to try and step you through it, but this is a differential abundance analysis here. And so basically, if you just look at the bars for now, the positive bars here on the x-axis, which is in log base 2 fold change, so mainly just a fold change on a log base 2 scale. These positive bars are organisms that were more abundant in the top of the biomat, while the negative bars over here are organisms that were more abundant in the bottom of the biomat when compared to each other. And so, and on the secondary y-axis, we also have relative abundance of each of these organisms, with the open circles being in the top and the closed circles in the bottom. And then we also tried to assign a putative function to each of these organisms to better understand what's going on in the top and the bottom. And basically, to summarize this, we're seeing in the top the phototrophic community. So we have phototrophs, and then we have algal symbionts and largely aerobic organisms that consume simple sugars. And then in the bottom here, we have a heavily reducing community with fermenters, methanogens. We're also seeing our anammox organisms, Brachydiaceae, can red there, and sulfate reducers as well in the kind of yellowish pentagons. So to explore some of these profiles a bit further and to focus in on a few organisms of interest, we did quantitative PCR. On the top here, we have HCS, which is for looking at anammox organisms. And on the x-axis, we have top, middle, and bottom at different sampling spots with about 2 meters, 30 meters, and 50 meters away from the inlet. And basically, what we're seeing is a pretty big enrichment of anammox organisms in the bottom of the wetland closest to the inlet. We also overlaid the pore water profiles I mentioned earlier. We have nitrate and ammonium overlaid on this graph here. And the biggest thing that jumps out, if you notice this broken axis here, is that ammonium is about 6 times greater concentration than the inlet nitrate. So we're getting this huge pooling of ammonium where we're seeing the most anammox organisms. This trend is also true later in the wetland, but it's not as pronounced. And then we also looked at sulfate reducers as well with the disimulatory sulfate reductase gene, DSRA. And we're seeing similar trends, heavy decrease of sulfate near the inlet and the most amount of sulfate reducers, especially in the bottom. To query or to ensure that we're actually producing sulfide from sulfate, so when you reduce sulfide, you produce sulfate. When you reduce sulfate, you produce sulfide. And we're getting a pretty good stoichiometric conversion of sulfate to sulfide here. So you might be asking yourself, why are we talking about sulfate now? We thought we were talking about nitrogen cycling, right? Well, it turns out that sulfide has quite a few effects on the nitrogen cycle. It can inhibit denitrification at the nitric to nitrous oxide step. It also inhibits nitrogen fixation and nitrification, which we're not too concerned about since we're already starting with nitrified wastewater effluent. And additionally, it can promote the disimulatory nitrate reduction to ammonium, so which is, again, nitrate going to ammonia here. And this is thought to occur because it's energetically more favorable for sulfide to be oxidized and reduce nitrate than denitrification. So now it might be a little bit more apparent why we're seeing anammox if we're having our nitrogen cycle cut off here and promoting nitrate to ammonium. You can see we're left now with the precursors for anammox. To show that this is actually occurring, we did microcosm studies. In panel A here, you can see the orange is nitrate, the blue is sulfide, and the green triangles are ammonium. And so when we have nitrate combined with sulfide, we see a pretty good production of ammonium. I think it's about 35% of the nitrate that was reduced was converted to ammonium. In B, this microcosm wasn't amended with sulfide, and you can see we're still getting about the same rate of nitrate reduction. However, there's no ammonium production. So this was kind of our test case to show that sulfide is in fact causing this production of ammonium. And C here is just a control without nitrate, and again, there's no ammonium production. So the conclusions from all of this data, when you put it all together, we're seeing the field observations. Especially near the inlet, we have nitrate going down, sulfate going down, indicating the production of sulfide and an increase of ammonium. And we're also seeing an increase of anammox and sulfate reducers in this region as well. Microcosms have shown the ability of this biomat to produce sulfide, and that nitrate in the presence of sulfide produces ammonium. And this leads us to kind of our final message, is that the reduction of sulfate and the subsequent production of sulfide causes the production of nitrate and ammonium via disimulatory nitrate reduction to ammonium, which is then used to support an anammox community. So what are the implications of this? DNRA allows for the recycling of nitrogen, right? It's not getting gassed off, it's just kind of cycling within our system. That might not be the greatest when you're trying to remove nitrogen, but it doesn't seem to really be affecting it. We could have perhaps less nitrous oxide production. As I mentioned, sulfide prevents the production of nitrous oxide, which is a potent greenhouse gas. However, I think there are probably other overriding factors in this. Additionally, sulfide could be an indicator of anammox, especially in the terrestrial environment. This kind of nutrient cycling process has been shown in the oxygen minimum zones and the dead zones of the ocean I was talking about earlier. This has been observed, but this it's been theorized to occur in freshwater and terrestrial environments, but nobody's proven it yet. So basically, overall, anammox may be more prevalent than we previously thought in freshwater and terrestrial environments. So this brings us to chapter 4, and this is going to look at the microbial ecology of open water unit process wetlands from startup and compare pilot and demonstration scale system. This here is a picture of the Prado wetlands. So this wetland is about 30 meters across and about 250 meters long. And this system, there's three wetland cells here. They're all running in parallel, receiving water from the Santa Ana River. So this is in Southern California. And Orange County Water District was generous enough to build this for us, mainly based on the preliminary data that we gathered from the pilot scale system. They're pretty interested in the trace organic degradation as well as nitrate removal capabilities of the system. So since we had a brand new system to look at from startup, we wanted to understand how quickly the community would establish. Will all three ponds have the same community? And how does this community shift over time? And additionally, we wanted to see how closely does this community resemble the pilot scale system at Discovery Bay? If it's in a different geographic spot and also receiving a slightly different influent water, will we get the same community formed? The experimental design was pretty simple. Scott Nygren was kind enough to send me samples monthly for about 2.5 years. We did DNA extraction and 16S RNA sequencing as we did in previous studies to analyze the community. And at the end, we had about close to 300 total samples to look at. So this is the first kind of summary of all 300 of these samples. This is the top 20 most abundant families we found in this system. And this is a heat map with the red indicating a higher abundance, and the white means nothing was seen, and the blue is a lower abundance. And so what really stands out in this heat map is this group of organisms here. You can see they're largely phanogens, fermenters. So it took about 9 months for this anaerobic community to establish within the system. We think this is largely due just as a function of biomat depth. You have to limit oxygen diffusion into the biomat before you can establish an anaerobic community. This is similar to the PCOA I showed similar. This is a detrended correspondence analysis, which we had to use because we had such a long time series. It causes artifacts in normal principal coordinate analyses. And so if you look at the colors here, the startup of the wetland was December 2013, and these orange reddish dots here. And the community shifts to the left over time. And this dashed line here is our kind of our 9 month stabilization period, so the separation between samples. And you can see after this, about 9 months here, the community starts to stabilize and just cluster around this area. What's really interesting is that the Discovery Bay samples, so those 36 samples I was talking about in the previous chapter, those are also graphed on here in the gray triangles. And you can see after this 9 month period, the community looks very similar. The Discovery Bay community, the Prado community looks very similar to the Discovery Bay community by this analysis. To look at the overlap between these communities further, we did a core microbiome analysis. So you're basically looking at all the organisms which are essentially the same in the samples, are found in the same samples, and there's actually quite a bit of overlap. They're both aerobic and anaerobic organisms here, and about 50% of the total sequences we analyzed fell into this core microbiome, so over half the community is found in both places. To put this in perspective, this is about, there's a study that did a core microbiome on anaerobic wastewater reactors running in parallel, receiving the same water, and they had about a 50 or 60% overlap in their core microbiome, or 50 or 60% of their sequences fell into their core microbiome. So this is pretty amazing, actually, that you can design these two separate, geographically separated systems receiving, you know, different influent water concentrations and still form pretty much the same community. The diatoms were, as I talked about previously, were a pretty big player at Discovery Bay. And so we were also able to track diatom abundance at Prado as well. And so this is just general diatom abundance. You can see they started colonizing the system from startup, essentially. It looks like they might have gone down in the first summer and then come back in the winter. These are relative abundances of diatom, so we just could have had blooms of other organisms in the system. And we also had a disturbance event after the first year where the forebay was reconstructed and water sat stagnant in the cells for about 2 or 3 weeks. And so this could have led to a decrease of diatom abundance, but you can see, you know, a year or two later, they've come back. We did SEM imaging again of these diatoms, and A here are the diatoms seen at Discovery Bay, and B are the diatoms seen at Prado, and you can see they're pretty much the same exact species. So we're getting the same almost monoculture of diatoms in both systems, which I definitely didn't expect at all, but I think this is kind of the main reason we're seeing such overlap in the communities, is because the diatoms are kind of the driving environmental factor in this system, being the primary producers. And then this is data that Samantha Baer put together utilizing Justin Jasper's model. And so the model predictions of Prado for nitrate treatment and trace organic treatment, I used atenolol as an example here. The predicted removal rates of the dashed lines and the open markers are the values that we measured, the removal rates. We measured it within the cell. And you can see these values line up really well. And as I mentioned, after the first year, the HRT was changed. It was running at hydraulic retention time. It was running at 2 days the first year, and then we changed the cells to a 1 day, 4 day, and 2 day HRT. As you can see, that affects performance quite a bit. We're getting the best performance with the 4 day HRT down here. But the model's lining up really well with from the model developed for the pilot scale system, stacking up really well to the performance we're seeing at the demonstration scale system, which I think is in part driven by the same community in both systems. So conclusions, community establishes quickly, starting with diatoms and aerobes, and then we see the emergence of anaerobic organisms. And then after about 9 months, or when this anaerobic community emerges, it's converging with the Discovery Bay community. And so basically we're saying that if you design these systems the same way, independent, somewhat independent of probably water parameters and geography, that you can form the same community which will achieve the same treatment goals. And so that's pretty much all of the chapters in my dissertation, and now I just want to quickly talk about some future directions that we've started going down. So wetlands are the main natural source of methane. And so we wanted to understand greenhouse gas emissions from these wetlands. As I said before, these are kind of heavily photosynthesizing wetlands, so we were hoping that we could get they would be a net carbon sink. And because of the heavily saturated water column with oxygen during the daytime, that we could mitigate some of the methane production. So this was a lab experiment done with different depths of biomat. Our hypothesis was that if you have a deeper depth of biomat, you're going to get overall more greenhouse gas fluxes, just because you have the same amount of photosynthesizing surface area, but you have a larger biomass, anaerobic biomass. And so that trend kind of held true, but we had a few problems with the experiment, but it seemed promising. The main trends I want to talk about are the diurnal cycling. So the gray boxes here indicate when the lights were off, and the white is when they were on. And you can see actually that this y-axis for CO2 flux here, it's actually all negative. So the largest amount of CO2 flux, we didn't really have a net positive CO2 flux in this experiment. And I think that's just due to kind of the ideal lab conditions we ran this experiment under. And then methane was pretty interesting. You can see there's almost no methane production during the daytime, but when the lights go out, you get these spikes of methane. and we didn't see too many trends with nitrous oxide. We took this gas measuring system out into the field, out to the Prado wetlands, and we did a 24-hour gas sampling event. A lot of thanks to Brent for helping me out with that. It was a lot of work. And so we have inlet, middle, and outlet of the wetland here over 24 hours, and there are some anomalies in this data for sure. We had a couple disturbance events, I think, where we disrupted the wetland biomat, causing extra gas flux to occur. But you can see here for CO2 at the top, we kind of saw, especially in the middle of the wetlands, that we're getting more CO2 flux at night, as we would expect. Methane, the outlet kind of shows our expected methane fluxes with increasing at night, as we saw in the laboratory experiments. And then nitrous oxide was pretty consistent throughout the wetland, but it largely corresponded to inlet, middle, and outlet, or nitrate concentration. So the more nitrate, the more nitrous oxide flux we had. Overall, these fluxes were very low, though. That's a one right there. Additionally, we wanted to compare the fluxes of the open water cell to the surrounding wetlands as well. The main message I wanted to get across with this figure, these are the open water cells here, these bars. And you can see these were all taken the same day, as close to the same time as we could. It was in the morning, and you can see there's a pretty good net CO2 sink within these wetlands, while the surrounding areas are definitely a source of CO2. Methane emissions were about the same throughout the wetland as well. So final summary of this work. The open water cell develops a benthic diatomaceous community. It has a broad diversity of microorganisms. This biomat contributes to trace organic degradation and nitrate removal. And I think it's likely so good at removing nitrogen because of the photosynthesis by the diatoms. They have kind of this internal source of carbon production, which a lot of systems don't have, and is pretty key for denitrification to occur. We showed that anammox organisms are supported by sulfide-induced assimilatory nitrate reduction to ammonium, and similarly designed yet geographically distinct systems can select for the same community and achieve the same treatment goals. And I think there's a lot of future applications and research to be done on these systems, which are starting to be explored largely in saline waters right now. So Rachel Scholes is working with David Sedlat, working on RO brine to see if they can remove, if this system is effective at removing some of these pollutants, and also looking at if we're seeing a similar community formed, or at least a photosynthesizing community. And Michael Vega is working in our lab now with produced water and looking at nitrogen removal, probably some metal removal as well. And I think there's a really good opportunity to treat PAHs, or polyaromatic hydrocarbons. As I mentioned before, with the aromaticity of these compounds, they're really susceptible to photolytic degradation. However, the parent compounds of the photolytic degradation can actually be more toxic. The daughter compounds can be more toxic than the parent compounds. But then the daughter compounds are more labile to biological degradation. So you can get complete degradation of these compounds with this system due to the multiple removal pathways. And then also, I think this system really needs to be explored for use in agriculture and ammonia removal. Michael's starting to look at ammonia removal, and it looks promising, but we're just not sure how effective it would be. But that's a really big problem for nitrogen pollution. Overall, my work has been used in 7 different publications, 2 first author publications, and the last one down here is a review paper. And acknowledgments, I would like to start off by thanking my advisor, Josh Sharp. I thought we made a really great team throughout this whole process. If I would ever get stuck or hit a dead end, Josh would always be there to kind of pull me out and get me refocused and moving along again. And my whole committee was just great, really supportive of my research and always accessible. And then there's just so many other faculty members that helped. Especially like to thank David Sedlak. He was one of the leaders of Renew It, as well as the Open Water Cell project. Junko, who we shared a lab with, has just been great and enthusiastic. And as I mentioned, Carter Nelson. John McCray has just been an awesome department head since I've been here. And then the admin and the civil and environmental department, Tim, Juanita, Angela, have been awesome. And I also wanted to thank Pam from Stanford, who was just here. And the GEM Lab as a whole has just been amazing. It's been kind of just like a big family. It's a largely kind of student-run lab. It's shared between three different professors, which I'm actually thankful for. Some of John and Junko's senior students when I first moved in here were just really amazing and kind of got us started. And you know, all of Josh's students, have, you know, we all made really great friends. Sometimes it was hard to get work done in lab just because, you know, just screwing around so much, having such a good time in there. So, yeah, and then I had a whole other community to interact with as well. The Renew It people ended up living with a couple of them. Pato and Pim were, and Julia, three of them actually, were you know, amazing roommates as well as colleagues. And I also wanted to thank the people at Orange County Water District, especially Megan Plumley, Scott Nygren, and Jason. They were, you know, they just made everything so easy to coordinate with, and they were just so helpful with sending samples and keeping everything going. And I wanted to thank the student mentees. I had quite a few of them, but they were all awesome, and I think pretty much all of them are doing pretty great things right now, all related to science. And then, of course, I wanted to thank my family, my mom and dad, and my sister who came out here today, and my girlfriend Beta, who's been putting up with me for a while now. And as Josh mentioned, Dr. James Gray, who kind of got me started. So that's it. Thank you, and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Your data would suggest that it's going to be pretty hard that if you make this permutation of that to affect that, right? Because you made two separate wetlands and they both ended up almost identical.
Yeah, I think with this system design, the community is really robust, like even changing HRTs, all of that. I'm not sure if you would actually be too successful at changing the community. I think. I think I forgot to mention this actually.
The flip side might be that it gives you resiliency or.
Yeah, exactly. Like, we were able to hold stagnant water in there for 2 or 3 weeks and it still bounced back. So, I think that's really. I think that's a benefit from an engineering standpoint, arguably, right? And I think why we're getting that community forming, one of the big reasons is the geotextile liner we're putting down. It's kind of separating the community from the native soil environment. So, you kind of have this fresh slate to start with. I don't know, maybe there's some things we could do to, you know, what we're putting in the bottom of the wetland to modify the community. I think Josh is actually going to be looking into some of that in the future at Prado. We have another system we're setting up there too. So that's something
we're
trying to look at as well.
The rhetoric of 15 years ago when I would be in panels was like, once we understand this community, we're going to be able to modify it, and that's going to like revolutionize how we do wastewater treatment or something.
Modify, I think, some of the bulk properties, aerobic, anaerobic zones. There's been studies shown you can add like zeolite to the substrate and you can get greater ammonia oxidation. But this is a pretty unique wetland system too, so I wouldn't say what's demonstrated here is true across all wetland systems.
How
Yeah, I think the climate is pretty similar. It's, you know, California, Mediterranean climate. Both of them are inland. Both of them are get really hot during the summer. So I think the climates are very, very similar, actually. Yeah, I think it definitely is. Would the same community form in Colorado, for example? We would have to just try it out and see. We only have an N of 2 at this point, right? So it's hard to extrapolate too much from that. Linda? Yeah, sunlight is, sure, that's also a factor, definitely.
With the same sense of how much might pull out of this, not much sun, so we have low productivity.
We would have to just try it out and see if we only have. I'm going to guess it's largely temperature driven, but we don't have any data or anything to back that up. But yeah, sunlight is definitely a factor as well. I think I'm planning on going to Sydney to work in Professor Mike Manfield's group, working on a biogas project. So some more anaerobic microbiology, probably applied microbiology, which I'm happy about as well. Probably in September or October or something. I got to start figuring that out starting tomorrow.
Tomorrow is thesis revisions.
No, I'm gonna let that sit. I have until August 29th, so.
No more questions. Excuse everybody.
Right. Yeah, thank you guys all for coming. You're invited. What was my time on that?